One of my pet theories is that energy is wasted on the youth and that we use up what the Lord gives us when we're so young. You only get so much, and the way we all mindlessly run around when we're that age uses up vast quantities of it. At least that's my excuse anyway. It doesn't work with my wife either. She doesn't buy it. Well, I'm happy to be back again. I do have surgery tomorrow morning very early. And I actually scheduled it around today. I said to the doctor, anytime after August 4th. He wasn't happy with that, but here I am. So pray that he doesn't take it out on me tomorrow morning, I guess. I have the privilege, I guess, I'm not sure every family has one, but I'm sort of the family historian, the collector of all the stuff nobody really wants, the pictures of all the people that went before us, the keeper of the location of the cemeteries that after a while you forget. After two or three generations, you forget who's where. One of my complications was some of them moved. They were in a cemetery at a Baptist church in Philadelphia, and the city raised the street, and the cemetery flooded. So they moved everybody to Westminster Cemetery in I guess it's Lower Merion. So they were a little hard to track down. So I found all these people, and I found all these pictures of people, and one of the things that sort of got me semi-excited, I guess, was I found pictures of my grandparents on the boardwalk of Ocean City in 1920, and there they were, and one of the things that it sort of pointed out, and I did a little bit of research on it, is that back then, when you went to the boardwalk, especially at night, you dressed up. Coat and tie for the men, long dresses for the ladies, and that was the deal. You dressed up. Well, you go to the shore tonight, you're not going to see any of that. In fact, if you look at it, you don't see much of that in church anymore either. One year I had one of my elders was taking the offering. I think by God's grace it was the evening offering. And he shows up in a t-shirt and shorts. And naturally, I pointed that out to everybody in the congregation because he was a close friend of mine and just sort of giving him a hard time. And I'm not saying there's anything right or wrong with that. It's just the culture changes all the time. Somewhat, I don't know, it's probably 40 or 50 years ago now, if you worked for IBM, you had to wear a white shirt and a narrow tie, and you were not allowed to have facial hair. Because that acted as a barrier between you and the other people. I mean, it was no critique of it. It was just harder to relate to somebody. That was their argument. And everybody looked the same. They all had the same haircut, the same attire, usually a dark suit and a narrow tie and a white shirt. Well, again, today, that's not the case. It's changed dramatically. Well, you know, you can tell people by the way they dress. In some issues, if you saw an Amish man, you could tell he was Amish because of his attire. Well, what about us? This is really going somewhere. Just give me a minute. What about us as Christians? Can people tell that we're a believer by the way we dress? We've read the passage for today in Colossians 3. And it's basically about Christian attire. How much control do we have about that attire? If we fall short, which we all know by virtue of the fact that we're sinners, we all know that we fall short, but we're very accommodating to ourselves. We extend all kinds of mercies to us most of the time, not all the time. Well, he says in Colossians 3, verse 12, put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved. So before we really dig into it, it sort of begs the issue, who are we? What's our identity in all of this? Now he's writing to a city, mostly to a church, who's sort of under siege by a culture, much as we are. And he's writing to these people and he said, put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved. You see, as a believer in Jesus, that's who you are. By God's grace, by grace through faith, etc. We are God's chosen, chosen by Christ. Ever seen those commercials? Probably for an insurance company or something. It's as easy as this, where these two guys are picking basketball players and one of them chooses Shaq or something. I mean, versus a little boy. I mean, there's another one with a couple of baseball players and they call this famous one forward. And it's an obvious choice. The idea is it's an obvious choice. Well, God chose you. Isn't that weird? Have you ever thought about that? Why did God choose you? Look in the mirror. Why did he choose you? Ask yourself, why did he choose me? One of the men that was used by the Lord to write the Faith in Order, it's a man named Carl Castle. He just died a few years ago. And Carl, when he would discuss that, and the concept of God choosing him, would be moved every single time to tears because he was so overwhelmed with gratefulness that God chose him and recognizing all of the sins that God had to overlook in the blood of Christ, but had to overlook in order to choose him. There is nothing, we say repeatedly and correctly, there is nothing to recommend us to God. We are not better than anybody else, than someone who wasn't chosen. And our job is to not figure that out. Our job is to present the gospel to everyone, right? But you were chosen. It's not an accident that you're a Christian. You were picked by God. Ephesians 1, verse 4, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him in love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ according to the purpose of his will. You were chosen. So let that fill you with gratefulness and motivate you to live for him who chose you. And we were made holy. We were made holy. That's a hard one to grasp, isn't it? You look in the mirror again, or you remember the things that you don't really want to remember, but you remember them anyway, your failings and your sins. And I'm not holy. If all of my thoughts were broadcast to the entire world, I, and along with probably everybody else, would be somewhat embarrassed, maybe more than somewhat. We were made holy for eternity by God. Hebrews 10, and by that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. Hebrews 13, so Jesus also suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood. You know that word, sanctify, to be made holy, basically. So you were made holy. That's who you are. And you wake up in the morning and you look in the mirror, you know, I'm part of the family of God. And I'm holy. That's not a bad way to start. As a challenge to you, I'm holy and I'm loved by God. You ever feel unloved? Disrespected? You're loved by God. That's what he says here. And Jude says, to those who are called beloved in God the Father and kept for Jesus Christ. Loved by God. So it all starts with your identity. Remember who you are, child of God, chosen, adopted, made holy, cleaned up, and loved. So here's sort of a question for us. If we're chosen and adopted, made holy and loved, if that's true, then if we're called along with that, according to his purpose, Romans 8, which he says is to conform us into the image of Christ, if those two things are true, then don't you think it might make a difference in our lives if we worked with him to accomplish that instead of resisting and pushing back against it? Wouldn't it make maybe a little difference if we practiced what that is? Now, this is the part where I think sometimes in our passion for the grace, the doctrines of grace, that we sort of treat ourselves as if we're totally passive. There's nothing we ever can do, and that's absolutely true for salvation. But as far as working with God, being used by God and all those other things, there are some things that not only we can do, but we are called to do. And Scripture makes it very clear, I want you to do these things. So it might make a difference if we practice being those things. If you want to get good at a sport, you practice endlessly. I had a coach in volleyball. We were a very successful coach. He won the state championships about a dozen times. He would walk you through each position on the court. Very different game than it is today. It's much faster today. But for defense, he would put up the block, and then he would have everybody positioned. Then they would rotate one, everybody would do it again. Rotate one, everybody would do it again. We did that every day. It was so painful. It was not fun. But in the middle of the game, everybody knew where to go. And we were the best practiced team probably in the state. That's why he won every year for almost a decade. Well, what if our life's like that as a believer? What if instead of driving along or walking along or interacting with people, your only thought is you? What if instead of that, you respond with the thoughts that come from the Holy Spirit? And your first thought is, well, there's someone that needs a kind hand, or there's someone that needs this. And your first thought is, how can I practice being loving or kind or holy? Or there's an opportunity to put somebody down and make yourself look better. And your first thought is not that, but your first thought is, how can I be holy in this moment? Now, we don't normally do that, do we? But nonetheless, it might make a difference in the way we grow and the degree to which we're conformed, perhaps more quickly, into the image of Christ. He says, which you talked about last week, put off certain things, verse 8 of Colossians 3. Now you must put them all away, anger, wrath, malice, slander, obscene talk from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing you have put off the old self with its practices. Put off. That's a command. That's something apparently we can do, or we wouldn't be told to do it. So put it off. Don't do it. Isn't that ridiculously simple? Don't do it. I feel like gossiping. Don't do it. Just don't do it. Well, I have a short temper. Really? Are you going to explode all over the policeman that stopped you for speeding? Probably not. Even if you have a short temper, you might explode over the person that cut you off if your temperament is such like that. But you wouldn't do it if it was a police officer that cut you off. You would control yourself. We can control ourselves. Even those with the worst tempers can control themselves. They just don't feel like it. That's true with other sins as well. Put it off. You are part of God's family. If you've been in church any length of time, you've heard this illustration. It's a tried and true. I think it's probably a true story. You've all heard, I'm sure, of Alexander the Great. And he was in a battle. And while the fighting was its fiercest, one particular soldier was filled with the certainty of death and fled the scene of the fighting, exposing himself as a great coward, which was an unbelievable embarrassment to the Greeks. They didn't do that. I can relate to that guy. I mean, when you've seen any of the movies of these guys getting spears thrown at them, I can't imagine fighting in that just for extending the empire. The man was, of course, tracked down after he fled the scene, detained and forced to wait for a meeting he had with his commander. So he's shown before Alexander himself. He's brought into his tent, forced to stand before this amazing leader, and seconds, it says, seemed like hours in that setting. And barely able to lift his head, he stood trembling before the general. And Alexander finally broke the piercing silence, and he said, "Soldier, why did you run?" And he said, "Well, sir, I left because I was afraid." And then Alexander said, and for in that moment he said he would have preferred a death sentence instead of a question. Alexander said, "What's your name?" And he already knew his name, and he knew his name, but he said, "Well, my name is Alexander." And he said to him, "Well, then change your behavior or change your name." Now, as I said, if you've been to church any length of time, you've heard a pastor use that. It's one of our favorite collective illustrations because it really makes a great point. I even said that to my nephew one time when he was a young man. very young man acting out. I said, look, either change your behavior or change your last name. I don't want you associated with us if you're going to act like that. I remember the illustration. I was just sort of applying it, probably inappropriately, but nonetheless. Either change your actions or change your name. We, all of us, don't we have the opportunity to choose practically every single day to live like Christ versus living like the world? So make your choice. Remember your identity. And then the rest of that verse. Put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Put on. In other words, he's telling us to change our wardrobe. And he's also telling us that as a believer, unlike our culture, your wardrobe from the time you accepted Christ should never change. It should always be like that. It should always be you, us, putting on compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. That should be it. Compassionate heart. Some people are more compassionate than others. It's just the way they're wired. I'm a fixer. Most of the time, I'm not instantly compassionate. I have a friend. I was in Kenya with him on a mission trip years ago. A lot of you know him, Pastor Mahuran, Ron Mahuran. And we came across this village of children. I guess everybody else was out working in the fields or building things. And these children were there. And they were hungry, and they were malnourished. And they're standing there with their incredibly large, incredibly sad eyes. And Pastor Mahuran was standing there weeping, just weeping. He could hardly move for compassion for these poor children. I was there looking for food. I mean, I'm just a fixer. It's just the way I'm wired. But he is just an incredibly compassionate man. Compassionate hearts. Genuine care about the feelings of others, a heart of pity. It's a sense of sympathy, of empathy, approaching life with compassion. And in that moment, it's not thinking of you, it's you thinking of them and not thinking of yourself at all. Well, I can't stop and help this person, I'll be late. Yeah, but maybe helping is more important. And kindness, it's an action word. Loving words and actions show care and concern, the ability to control your self-centered desires in order to serve the needs of others. One ancient historian or theologian wrote of another theologian, he said, I began to love him, not at first as a teacher of the truth, which I despaired of finding in the church, but as a fellow creature who was kind to me. What an open door of kindness can be in everything. You wanna make a difference? Personally, somewhat from experience, I don't think all of our evangelistic schemes work very well. I've tried over 30 years most of the current ones you read about, you see advertised, or they sell different packages of, or they have seminars to train you on. We tried a lot of them. We even had success in bringing people to the church, and almost no success in bringing people to the Lord. But you know what worked, in a manner of speaking? Was just people, loving people, helping people. 85%, they say, of people who come to Christ come in a crisis. Just being there to listen, not to judge, to help when you can help, to shine shoes for a funeral, you've heard stories like that. Just being there when so many times no one's there. Visiting old folks in a home and listening to their stories, that's a ministry. And that's a kindness, because so many of them don't even get a visit from their family. It's a hard thing to do. But if we're kind and focused on that person and listen to them and don't always try to help them, but we just listen. I had to rebuke an elder board one time, not one of my own. It's easier to rebuke an elder board that's not your own. But they were having a battle with the women of the church. And they were trying to come up with a solution. I can be too impulsive to speak sometimes. And I said, aren't you men married? Well, yeah. I said, you haven't learned this yet? I said, the ladies aren't looking for an answer. They don't want your wonderful intelligence to solve the problem for them. They want you to listen. Just listen and nod your head and listen to what they say. You haven't done that. Actually, they never did, but the problem didn't go away. That's a hard thing for husbands to learn. We want to fix. And wives too often don't have our ear, and they want an ear to listen to where they are and what they're doing. By God's grace, I've been married 53 years, so I figured some of it out along the way. So, and the reason for being married 53 years is, by God's grace, I chose the right person, and it's more her than it is me that got us this far down the road. I assure you of that. Kindness and humility, the right view of ourselves, it comes from an awareness of our submissive status before God. Not proud or thinking of others, but thinking of others before yourself. Poor in spirit, you've heard that? Regarding others better than ourselves. That's what we're supposed to be. Philippians 2, if there's any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord of one mind, do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interest, but to the interest of others. Humility. I might have told this story. It's one of my favorite stories, but I was in a... My brother's an artist, and he and I are polar opposites in everything. I'm not going to go into the details, but in everything. So he had an art show down at Ocean City. We went there a lot back in the day, don't anymore. But there I am for most of an afternoon, sort of a captive to all of his friends. His friends are not my friends. They live in a different world. They have different likes and dislikes and whatnot. So I'm trying to love my brother by being there for him, supporting him. So I came upon this interesting experiment. I don't remember what motivated it. So I thought, okay, I'm not going to say a word about me to any of these people. All I'm going to do is talk to them about them. So one by one, I went around the room. And I said, tell me about yourself. What do you do? And how do you do this? And that sounds really neat. Explain that to me. Did the whole room that way. And it was very interesting, the stuff I found out. And I just sort of chalked it up. And that was one way to engage people. And so my brother came to me after it was all over. He says, what got into you today? I said, what do you mean? He said, my friends thought you were the greatest person they had ever met. I said, really? I said, I didn't talk about me at all. I listened. What I did was listen to them. Oh, they loved you. I did it again at my sister's place. She has another whole different set of friends. The same thing happened. And these are people who are opposite from me politically and well, like I said, other ways. And it was quite extraordinary. You want to impress people? Not that you should want to impress people. Impress the Lord. But if you really do, don't, and this is extremely hard, mind you. Don't we want to share our good news with everybody? My wife and I have been on a lot of trips. So when we get back from the trip, we talk about the trip. I'm sure anybody who knows us well is sick and tired of hearing about our trips. And we would do a whole lot better if we wouldn't talk about them. It's so bad that in Sunday school last week, the Sunday school teacher mentioned the fact that we were on a trip as an illustration. I thought, this is not good. It's telling us something about us. The average person, I just said this to my brother not too long ago. I said, you got to understand, he looks really, really good for, he's younger than I am. He looks really, really good. I said, no one cares what you look like. People only care what they look like. They don't care if you have a six pack at 70 And he does. I said, they don't really care. I said, they don't care that I don't have hair. The only person who cares that I don't have hair is me. And I've gotten over it a long time ago, so it's not that big a deal. But we're just worried, aren't we? Is that true? Are we worried about the way we look, we go out, we don't look stupid? Sort of blunt way of putting it, but nobody else cares. But we're all blessed when somebody notices something different, that they're focused on us, they're loving us, they're being kind to us. And meekness, the kind of gentleness Jesus used to describe himself and his yoke in Matthew 11:29, take my yoke upon you. It's gentle. I'm gentle and lowly of heart. That's what we're called to be. And he's sort of describing this as something we put on, like your shirt or your dress in the morning. You're putting this on every single day. This is the change. This is what he's writing to these believers in Colossae. Now think about that for a second. Isn't that mostly dramatically different from the world we live in if we respond and behave in that way? It's incredibly different from most of the people you run into. And he goes on to say that it doesn't end there. Well, I forgot patience. The ability to endure difficult situations and people without complaint, showing self-control, enduring one another. Be patient. How many times are you impatient when there's construction ahead and you're down to one lane? Another one of my favorite illustrations. It's great being sort of an itinerant pastor now. I can tell the same stories all the time. And if I forget where I tell them, I'm subject to repeating them. But I was delivering a friend of mine to JFK. And we were late. It's like 10 o'clock at night. And I'm coming back. And I ran over a nail. And I'm on the expressway. And the dashboard says, the back right tire is 20 pounds. My first thought was, I can live with 20 pounds. I can still drive with 20 pounds. My second thought was, 30 seconds ago, it was 35 pounds. I thought, okay, I'm in trouble. And I'm coming up to the tunnels on the Manhattan Thruway. So I pull over, and there's no side of the road. There was a little triangle where there was an exit. So I stopped there, and my right hand was bandaged from carpal tunnel surgery. And I had never used the jack in my car, and I couldn't get it open. I tried everything. It just wouldn't open. And I'm standing there thinking, here I am. I don't have a spare. I have a mini spare. I can't really do this. I should have called AAA or something. And I thought, instead of getting angry and throwing things around, I thought, you know what? Tomorrow morning, I'm going to be sitting at my desk drinking a cup of coffee. And this is just going to be a memory. And a great sermon illustration. I didn't think that, but so... although it has proven to be one. So I finally got the jack open. One car came close to hitting me, but he missed. And I got the tire on, and I got home. And the next morning, I'm sitting at my desk, and I'm having a cup of coffee, and this thought comes across my brain. Here I am! It's a time machine. I'm here. And I thought that way the last time I was at the dentist, and it started to hurt. 20 minutes, I'm going to be a Dairy Queen. So it's a good thing. It's a good thing. And I sort of think that way about the surgery tomorrow. So 3-hour surgery, I'm going to sleep through it, I'm sure. but these qualities that he gives us are attributes of Christ, but they're supposed to be attributes of us. We know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to his purpose, for those he foreknew, he predestined to be conformed in the image of Christ. If we're practicing those things, we're working with the Holy Spirit to conform ourselves into the image of Christ. Now, we've often said, haven't we, that sometimes God needs to trip us or smack us to get us back in line. I might not use those words, but there have to be difficult situations in life that we learn from so that we're more conformed to Christ. But if we're working with him, you don't need all of that. And your life might progress faster. How much better would life be if we were more like Christ sooner rather than later? Now, we're never going to get all the way there, no matter what we do. Or that's certainly true. And then he says, verse 13, bearing with one another. And if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you. So you also must forgive, and above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. Put others first. A lot of one another's in here. Bear with one another. You know what that means? Put up with annoying people. That's what that means. I mean, we're going to all of us annoy somebody sometime, and somebody's going to annoy us. That's just the nature of life. It's what you do with it that's the problem. Put up with it, it says. That's exactly what it says. We get impatient with others' shortcomings or our own shortcomings. Bear with one another. Sometimes we rub each other the wrong way. What do you do at a board meeting, elders, when half the table wants to go one way and the other half the other way? Hopefully you don't fight each other. Some churches have that problem. We had a policy which was interesting. We had to be unanimous. But if it wasn't unanimous, we wouldn't pass it. But the person who didn't vote for it had to come back with an alternative the next month. And then the next month we would pass it if it wasn't after we prayed about it, because we wanted to be sure that the one who voted against it wasn't the only one that was actually hearing the Holy Spirit. So we at least gave it a month. Now, there's no right or wrong way to do that. But we didn't fight about it. And we agreed that when we left the room, we were on the same page. Forgive one another. Why did he say that? Because they weren't forgiving one another. Whenever we're being told to do something, it means they weren't doing it. Forgive one another. We all probably have somebody that we should forgive. Love one another. Without love, none of the other qualities fully develop. And imagine what life would be like if these kinds of virtues and principles were applied. If we loved one another. We live in a culture at the moment of virtual hate all the time. The nature of politics is to how badly can I disrespect my opponent? How much mud can I find to throw at them, or terrible things to say about them? That's not good. That's not good for us to get into that mindset. That's not a good mindset for the next generation to even be learning. It's successful sometimes in the short run, but it's not what we're supposed to do. When Jesus prayed his high priestly prayer, he prayed that there would be unity and that the world would know us by our love for one another, didn't he, in John 17? Do you think the churches in general have done that well? How many times have people left the church because they're angry? I had somebody leave. Lovely people. We're not being fed. That's a common complaint. We're not being fed. One of my elders said, you know the problem. He said, it's not with the food. They don't like the chef. 3 years later, they came back. Suddenly, the preaching got better. I don't think it was any different. It was what it was, or it is what it is. I think whatever they were upset about, they got over. Unity. Unity is more important than whatever you're upset about most of the time. We've been charged to show the world that love so that others might believe. We can do it, even if we have a short temper or it's not our natural response. By God's grace, we can do it. And then finally, the last couple verses here. And let the peace of Christ rule in your heart, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. That's a direct contrast to pride and judgmentalism, isn't it? Let the peace of Christ rule in your heart. Some of that, you get the peace when you're being obedient to Christ. There's just a certain peace about it. You pray about it, you move ahead, and there is this feeling that sort of comes about you. I'm not real big on feelings, but there's a sense in which there's not tension or conflict. You make a decision and there's no peace. Maybe take a step back and think about it. So why isn't there peace? Maybe the Lord's trying to tell me something. Let the peace of Christ rule in your heart. Let it be the umpire. When you make the decision, do you have that peace? And let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing you. And along with that, he writes, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Do you realize when we sing the songs, usually four in most churches these days for some reason, before, in the first part of the service, let's say, we're actually admonishing one another with the words that we're singing? We're actually teaching. We're all of us in this room teaching one another in that moment, according to this verse. Teaching and admonishing, and whatever you do, do everything in the name of the Lord, giving thanks to God the Father who allows us this opportunity. I think it was David Jeremiah I saw this piece from. Let the peace of Christ arbitrate your life, rule your heart. Let the word of Christ permeate your life, and let the name of Christ motivate your life. Now remember, with all of this, he's saying this is stuff we need to put on. These are behaviors we need to practice so that we'll be more conformed into the image of Christ and each of us individually more useful to God day by day. And that through his grace, others might come to him. Let's pray. Father, we are every bit as much in need of these words today as those in Colossae were there. We, all of us, fail every day to see others that are around us because we're so preoccupied with the personal issues we have, many of them absolutely necessary. And yet, Lord, you've called us to put on these new clothes, to put off the selfishness of the natural life, and put on the grace and love of the spiritual life. Help us to do it. Help us to start our day by reflecting on your word and the things we need to look for, the opportunities to show kindness and love. Lord, help each one of us to move forward from this day being useful to you, not looking for earth-shaking changes in our lives, but looking instead for just opportunities to help others. Help us to listen well and to care and to pray for others when we have that opportunity. Lord, I pray for this church and thank you for the work that they've done in so many different ways in this community, and pray in the days to come that you would use them significantly to reach others for Christ. We live in a time when many churches are struggling and many people are wandering and looking. Help us to have the grace to comfort them when they come, to help them find their way back or their way in here or wherever we are, but find what's best for them in the moment. Lord, use us to your glory, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you have questions about what you've just heard, or if you want to know more about what it means to follow Jesus Christ, I want to encourage you to check out our website, faithbfc.org. If you live in the Harleysville area and you're not part of a local church, we'd love to have you worship with us here at Faith. I look forward to meeting with you personally. But whether you live here or somewhere else, the important thing is to get plugged into a local church where you can grow in your walk with Jesus Christ and help others grow as you serve him.